Welcome to Speak the Truth. It's Sunday. My name is Gary Johnson, the founder and publisher of BlackMenInAmerica.com. Today is Muhammad Ali Day for us on Zoom. And there's a documentary that a lot of people have been talking about that's been produced, executive produced by Ken Burns. And let's just take a look at what it is and how
Muhammad Ali was an activist
start tonight.
Who fought to move America in a certain way.
I have too much to fight for, cause to fight for.
There was going to be an enormous price to pay for that.
Boxing was this much of his evolution. The person he is today is way bigger.
The price of freedom comes high. I have paid, but I am free.
Muhammad Ali starts Sunday, September 19th at 8, 7 Central, only on PBS.
Nobody knows Muhammad Ali better than our host, Mr. Harold Bell. And he's got, wow, you got your executive producer, the woman, you wear the pants, but she holds them up. We know that. Hattie's on there. So let me turn it over to you.
Thank you, Gary. Yes, kind of piggybacking off of Maryland Public Television, and as they previewed the upcoming series on their cable station, I want to thank, of course, our friend Jackie Jones for recommending me to Charles Robinson and Jessica Campbell. I was one of three panelists on the show. Of course, the other two was Sarah Burns, Ken Burns' daughter, and his son-in-law, Dave McMahon, I think his name is. So the three of us were on that show, and I thank everybody that that tuned in and sent me congratulations. What we want to do on today's Zoom Sunday, we're going to take a look back at Muhammad Ali. And a lot of people don't realize that that interview I did with Muhammad Ali, we only talked 2 minutes of boxing. The rest of it was about the game called life. And one of the things that impressed me more than anything else is that we talked about friendship. What is the definition of a friend? Gary, can we run that piece?
Yes, sir.
The rank that they have in life, and others perhaps in our eyes deserve more, but yet in the eyes of God, it's different. It is because they deserve it, though you don't see why and how. Like a friend said to a fellow I know named Billy, said, Billy, why are you so devoted to Mary? She's not beautiful. She's not attractive. Billy said, to see Mary, you must borrow my eyes. And I will say, when we judge people, do we see with the eyes of God? Do we see what different, what feelings God has towards them? And when we cannot see in this way, we have no right to question why others are in this or that position. Same way it is with friendship. I mean, friendship is an automatic action. Friendship is an innocent, unconscious, outgoing, a pure, deep feeling with depth. So therefore, no one can explain why one person is a friend of another.
They say that our friendship is like our shadows. They're sticking with you as long as you're in the sun, but once you cross over into the shade, the shadow disappears. How do you distinguish your friends?
Well, I wrote something once that says, friendship is a priceless gift that cannot be bought nor sold, but its value is far greater than a mountain made of gold. For gold is cold and lifeless. It can neither see nor hear. In time of trouble, it's powerless to cheer. It has no ears to listen, no heart to understand. It cannot bring you comfort or reach out a helping hand. So when you ask God for a gift, be thankful if he sends not diamonds, pearls, or riches, but the love of real, true friends. And this is how I feel about friendship. There are very few friends. A friend is one who is always wanting to give. See, nothing in return. Always a thought of giving, and he wants nothing in return. A real friend holds his life cheap if it's for his friend. Anyone considered anything more important than friendship has not yet learned the first lesson to friendship. Once we learn to regard the feelings and displeasures of our friends without looking for anything in return, then it is those who've truly learned the meaning of friendship. Looking for nothing in return, always a thought of giving and keep back nothing. And very few people do that. Most people, if they tip you a dollar for a cup of coffee, they look for, I thank you. And if you coffee costs 16 cents, you tip lady a dollar. She don't say thank you. Ain't that a rude so and so? You didn't really give because you're looking for something in return. Here's a lady holding a bag full of groceries and you hold a door for her. She walk right through, keep walking. Most persons didn't say thanks. You didn't really hold the door. See, very few people really give and don't look for nothing in return.
Wow.
Okay. All right. That's right. How many of you guys out there have friends like that? Do you have a friend? I could count mine on one hand. I still got some friends, though. I would not be sitting in the spot that I am now. But friends, man, friendship is poorly defined in our community. It really is. They always got their hands out. And then when you help them, they forget who they are and where they came from. And, man, there was an interesting video I had a couple of weeks ago, but we never got a chance to show it here on Zoom Sunday. And Gary said he had seen it too. It got about over 11 million hits. And then all of us have, of course, heard of the great musician, the genius Carlos Santana, right? Well, Carlos Santana had a drummer who was one of the original founders of the band. And his name was Marvin.
Marcus the Magnificent.
Marvin Malone, Magnificent Marvin Malone. And Marvin fell on hard times because of drugs and everything and had to end up leaving the band. And he ended up going to jail and came out. And what happened, this reporter was snooping around and found this guy living in, what's that thing called, a mobile?
RV or something.
RV. Found him living in an RV. And he struck up a conversation with him. And the guy told him, "Said, yeah, man, I used to be a musician. You know, I came down hard on my luck, but I used to be a musician with Carlos Santana." So the reporter, he said, "Is that right?" So the reporter went and found Carlos Santana. Carlos hadn't seen my man in over 10 years. Man, didn't know what had happened to him. Let's run that piece, Gary. Let's show you what friendship is really all about.
Hey, Marcus.
Yeah.
How you doing? Come on out for a second.
Hey.
How you doing? Remember me?
Yeah.
Come on out. I'll talk to you. I got something for you. I can't hear you. All right. Get some clothes on. How you been, man?
Oh, man. It's been all right.
You know, I did some research on you.
Yeah.
You're the real deal.
You thought I was kidding you?
No, I didn't know. You know, everybody tells me a bunch of stuff.
Yeah.
Well, I wanted to bring you something.
You did?
I did. You know what I wanted to bring you?
What?
For me.
Jesus. I forget your name.
My name's not important.
Yes, it is.
No,
to me, it is.
Your name is important. I brought you a friend.
Ooh. Man!
Marcus the Magnificent Malone.
Oh, my God. Oh, man.
Man.
Look at you.
Marcus the Magnificent Malone.
Man. You don't know how I'm afraid to get to see you.
Oh, Marcus, it's an honor to be in your presence, man. I always cherish you, man. You and your family were so gracious to us. We do cherish you, man. You know, we cherish you.
I'm a junior, you see, but I know.
Emose, yippee-ki-yay.
Yippee-ki-yay.
Emose, yippee-ki-yay.
Ah! That's right.
Ah!
You know, I put some words to that song.
You did, man.
Yeah. And I've been wanting to get to you, man. I can't believe this is true.
Well, we're going to hook up because of this gentleman. And, you know, I mean, God has a way, man. And,
yes,
and I know your mom is with us, man. Your mom's in my heart, in your heart. And
yeah.
She's watching out for both of us.
Jesus Christ.
You know, so, man.
Call you and say hello.
Oh, you will, man. We'll hook up. You know, we'll hook up together, man. Marcus the Magnificent Malone. All right. We will love you. We love your heart, Marcus.
My latest composition is I've caught you with your drawers down.
Oh,
I need you on here, man. Caught you with your drawers down. How many of us have been caught? It's a beautiful, beautiful
You're day. Rascal, man. Yes. It's an honor to be in your presence.
Yeah, this guy was the one of the original founders of the Carlos Santana band, and like I say, ran into hard times, man. And reporter went and found Carlos, man, and Carlos said, "Take me to him." And he came back and wanted to help him. And I was telling Gary, you know, Carlos was hooking things up for him. Then I read where right after that Malone was walking down the street from a shelter and a tire came off of a truck and hit him. And he was on life support, the last that I heard. And I was asking Gary about that. Gary said he had seen where Carlos Santana and Malone had hooked up in a jam session, but I have not found any further information about how healthy he is. But that was a real friend, you know, for a guy to come back and not forget somebody like that. And not, like I said, in our community, we forget easy, man. We forget easy. And I was thinking, I had at least 30-some millionaires that came through me before they were millionaires. And you know how many of them came back? Two. John Thompson's wife and David Alt. And I stopped to think about my relationship with Muhammad Ali, man, and the type of friend that he was, man, was unbelievable, man. Let me tell you something. He wasn't perfect. He was flawed. But, man, he was such a great human being, man. He cared about everybody. I ain't never heard him say nothing racist about nobody. You know, he loved this country, but that didn't mean that he could not criticize this country. You know, he discovered early that freedom was not free. And I was so fortunate to meet him in 1967. Petey Green put us together, didn't even realize it. I'm standing out in front of Ben's Chili Bowl one day about lunchtime, and Petey comes by and says, "Harold, we both were working for United Planters." He said, "Guess what? Muhammad Ali is up on the Howard campus." I said, "What?" I said, "Come on, let's go." He said, "No, man, I can't go. I got to meet with the boss." So I went up on campus, and then there was Muhammad Ali surrounded by all these young people, man, standing out in front of an administration building, man. Beautiful, beautiful day. There were hundreds of kids, man. And I worked my way all the way through the kids, and I ended up being almost nose to nose with him, right? So he talked about another 30 minutes, and he said, "Hey, I need somebody to take me on a tour of the campus of D.C. So he was talking to one of them pretty little girls. He wasn't talking to me. I said, "Come on, champ, I'll take you." So I grabbed him, and we walked down Georgia Avenue, man, and that was fantastic. I turned around, and it looked like it was a parade behind us. And as we were walking down Georgia Avenue, people were blowing their horns. Women were jumping out, leaving their cars in the middle of the street, coming over and hugging him, and he enjoyed it, man. That's one thing I love about Muhammad Ali. He was not afraid of our people. He was not afraid of our people. So we walked on down to the Howard Theater, which is at 7th and T, and he ended up down there shatterboxing with a guy named Harvey Cooper. And Jacques may remember Harvey Cooper. Harvey Cooper was one of the guys in the street, well-known, well-loved, and everything else. So Harvey challenged him, and they just had a ball, man. But that was the beginning, man, of a fantastic relationship, man. So I don't know what Ken Burns is a documentary going to be all about. It's going to be interesting. But I know sitting there with his daughter and with his son-in-law, you know, I felt, you know, they must have felt like fish out of water, because I was the only one that knew him up close and personal. So once again, you know, I got to thank Maryland Public Television for giving me the opportunity, man, to tell my two cents. So, Gary, you can take it from there.
Well, one of the things I'm curious, and I've heard several stories from you, but I've also seen several pictures where Hattie was with the champ. And I'm wondering, Hattie, what are some of your fondest memories of Ali?
Well, it's hard to pick out some from our experiences, but one I remember was up in a camp somewhere in the woods, and I don't know how I was at the car or somewhere, but anyway, I was going up the stairs.
Oh, no, that was in Philadelphia. That was the first reunion between Joe Frazier and Muhammad Ali. We went to Philadelphia with Jim Brown and Burt Sugar. We met them up there.
And where were you?
I was in a hotel.
I know you were there, but...
But this is
just Muhammad and myself met each other on the stairs outside.
And I was out looking for a paper.
And he was coming down. And I said hi to him, you know, because he just seemed, you know, concentrating on getting out. And he said, hi. And I said, you don't remember me? You know who I am? I said, Harold Bell. He said, kiss me on the cheek. So I said, oh, okay. And that was one I'll never forget. And then the other one was at the, not a concert, but a banquet. I know Harold will tell you about that.
Yeah, let me say that I had gone out hotel early in the morning. Muhammad Ali liked to work a walk in the morning, you know, between 5 and 6 o'clock. He'd get up and go walk by himself. That's what I say, he wasn't scared of his people. And I had gone out to find a newspaper to see what they had written about the tribute, because there was still some hostility between Joe Frazier and Muhammad Ali. And the family, Frazier family, had picked up on that. So it was a great, great tribute, and we enjoyed ourselves. So early that morning, I went out to get a paper, and I left Hattie in the hotel while I went out. And when I came back, there was Muhammad Ali with his arms around Hattie, and Hattie evidently told Harold Bell. He saw me, say, I said, yeah, and he kissed Hattie. But he was such a loving, loving individual. And she was getting ready to tell you about the other time, and Jackie knows about this, but this is legendary. After Muhammad Ali had beaten George Foreman in Zaire, Africa, the DC Chamber of Commerce had named him the athlete of the century. So, you know, since I was tight with Muhammad Ali, James Denson, the president of the DC Chamber of Commerce, called me. He said, Harold, your man is coming to town, and can you pick him up at National Airport? We named him an athlete of the century. I said, yeah, man, no problem. So I went out to the airport, and man, I'm looking for him, right? And he's over by the baggage area, and man, people all over the place. So I noticed Veronica, who I had never met, you know, she was sitting there frustrated, and she saw me. And I said, Veronica, I'm Harold Bell. I'm here to pick you guys up. She said, will you tell that fool to come on? I'm tired. So I stood up on the chair and hollered, champ, come on, man, we gotta go. He looked at me and said, Harold Bell, cool it. I'll be there when I get there. But that was what happened. And of course, that night at the tribute, had over 5,000 people up at the Sheraton Hotel. Standing room only, man. So I done been with him all day. I had to rush back home and get Hattie and bring her there for the tribute. So we're sitting at the table with our friends, Happy Miles and his wife and Veronica. And Mayor Washington is presenting him a plaque, right? Standing there presenting him a plaque. So the mayor get ready. He cut the mayor off. I said, hold it, Mr. Mayor. He said, Mr. Mayor, do you know Harold Bell? I said, oh, my God, what is he getting ready to do? Hattie looked at me like I was crazy. I didn't know what was going on. He said, do you know Harold Bell? So the mayor's looking out in the audience for me, and Muhammad told me to stand up. So the mayor said, yeah, I know Harold Bell. Who don't know Harold Bell? He said, well, let me tell you, Mr. Mayor, that's my friend. And I don't want nothing to happen to Harold on your watch. Do you understand that? Mayor shook his head, yeah, I understand. He said, you know what, Mr. Mayor? You are not as dumb as you look. And boy, that brought down the house, man. Now, only Muhammad Ali could get away with that. But that's the kind of a person that he was, man. And when people asked me, you heard the other night, when did I know I was the chosen one? Well, it's many stories where he made me the chosen one. And my cherished one was him coming back from Zaire after I'd been to Chicago to meet with him, because he asked me what did I want to do, I said, champ, I want to do a television special with you. So this was after he got through working out, man. He back here getting the rub down and everything. And Rockman, his brother, came and got me and said, champ, want to see you back in the dressing room. So I went back there, and he asked me, what you want to do, man? I said, I still want to do that interview, man. I want to do a one-on-one interview. He said, oh, that ain't no problem. We could do that in Zaire. I said, huh? Yeah, we could do it in Zaire. I said, man, I ain't going no Zaire. He looked at me. So what you mean you ain't going no Zaire? I said, man, I'm scared to fly across the ocean. Boy, he made fun of me, calling me cluck, 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 calling me chicken. I said, I don't care what you say. I'm not going to Zaire. And of course, that night we had dinner, and Rodney Brown, who was with me, Pat Patterson, getting ready to take us back to the airport. And he came up beside me and said, okay, since you chicken to fly across the ocean, you will get the first interview when I get back from Zaire after I knock this sucker out. I said, okay, he always talking crazy. I ain't paying no attention to him. I'm trying to get on back to the airport and take this plane back to D.C. So we got on back, came back, and a week or two later, they in Zaire. So I called Roy Jefferson. I said, man, let's go down to the Constitution Hall. Roy Jefferson, of course, of the Washington Redskins, my partner, and his wife, Candy, and Hattie, and I, we went down the Constitution Hall to watch closed circuit. So we down there, man. I'm scared to death, man. The Georges go wear him out, man. I'm scared, man. Everybody's scared, man. And I said, he gonna pull this off. I didn't know how. But, man, you know, that was one of the biggest fights of his career. He knocked Big George Foreman out in the eighth round, undisputed. George was an undisputed, undefeated heavyweight champion of the world, one of the greatest classes in history. So now we leave. Come back home 5 nights later, man. I'm lying in the bed. It's raining like hell. I'm sleeping good. So Hattie had put the phone over by me because Petey Green and John Thompson always calling me 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. So she put me by the phone. So the phone must have rang somewhere between 10:30 and midnight. And Hattie hunts me, get the phone. So I pick up the phone. I said, who's calling? I'm still sleeping, man. I'm sleeping good. He said, let me speak to Harold Bell. I said, who's calling, man? He said, let me speak to Harold Bell. And I said it again. He said, fool, this is the heavyweight champion of the world, Muhammad Ali. I said, straight up in the bed. Hattie looked at me said, like to say, what's up? I said, it's Muhammad Ali. She looked at me like I was crazy, turned over, went back to sleep. So the champ said, you still want to do that interview, man? I said, yeah, champ. He said, I'm in New York, man. I just got here. Here's the number where I can be reached. This was Sunday night. Bring your camera crew up Monday, and we'll do the interview Monday morning. So I didn't have no camera crew. I ain't had no money. I had no car. I had nothing. But I didn't get paid the Friday. So I called Rodney Brown, who had gone to Chicago with me, and to show you how God works. He and Will Williams, the other guy who was with me, who helped produce the show, were at PBS doing a special for Black History Month. So I called Ron. I said, Rodney, he said, what's up? I said, man, Muhammad Ali just called me. He said, fool, ain't no Muhammad Ali call you nothing. I said, Rodney, he just called me, man. I just got off the phone. He said, what's the problem? I said, he wants us in New York in the morning to do the interview. He said, what's wrong? I said, ain't got no car, ain't got no money. He said, hold it, man. Will is here. He has a credit card. I got the car, and PBS got the cameras. They rolled up on my apartment about midnight, and then I got in the car, cameras was in the back seat, and we rolled on into New York, man, and the rest is history, man. But you stop and think, what I was so impressed by is that he came back from one of the most difficult fights of his career, and guess what the first call he made? Not to Ed Bradley, not to Brian Gumbel, or Howard Cosell. He called Harold Bell, a little nobody trying to be somebody on a Black radio show, and made me the chosen one. That is a hell of a thing, man, for a man to be in a difficult fight like that. And he get back and he remembers to call me. So that's one of my cherished memories, man. Okay, I'm finished.
CJ, what you got?
I was just gonna to add, Mr. Bell, how do you feel, or why do you think is the case that you're consistently pretty much left out of these stories? You know Ali better than most of these people in the media trying to narrate these stories or trying to, run a narrative either way. But, why do you feel like you've kind of been left out of that conversation? And, how do you feel about that? And why do you think that is?
Well, yeah, I've been left out, and it's not a good feeling when I know my relationship with the champ, how close we were, and I just like I said, we can't blame Donald Trump for everything. We can't blame Ken Burns for leaving me out, because let me tell you something, man, about racism in America. Racism, there's nothing wrong with racism, man, when you want people around you to be comfortable, and he brought his daughter and his son and Jonathan I think that's his name. They came after my stuff, but I said no more. But they want people around them that they're comfortable with. I had no idea that Ken Burns has been with PBS for 40 years, man. So they had that lockdown for 40 years. Why don't we do that? Why don't we pull each other back and bring each other into our company to help each other become a success, So I don't blame Ken Burns, man. We don't have our own vehicles like PBS, NBC or CNN. We don't own anything. So we become selfish, man. We are some very selfish individuals. So I'm just been blessed, man, that I've been able to keep it moving because of, people like Maggie and Jackie and Gary, man. It's been difficult. But I think, Maryland Public Television all of a sudden had me on, and I was able to give my two cents on Muhammad Ali. So, everything in God's time and not in our time. So that's how I thanks for asking that question, CJ. But yeah, my own people don't give me any credit. So why should Ken Burns give me any credit? Jackie, somebody else?
Yeah, it was funny when I've known Charles Robinson at Maryland Public Television for a long time. So he came in my office a couple of weeks ago and said, we're going to do this piece on Muhammad Ali. And he was asking me if I thought Betty Baye, who's a longtime columnist at the Louisville Courier Journal, would be able to talk about Ali. Because, the museum is down there and all of that. And she had met Ali a few times. And I said, you can have Betty if you want to. I said, but you ought to call Harold Bell. And so he said, Harold Bell. I said, Harold Bell won the NABJ Pioneer Award a couple of years ago. He said, yeah, I remember that name. And I said, he's more than a sportscaster, which he was. I said, he's plugged into all of that. I said, but he and Ali were friends. I said, if you really want somebody who can talk about Ali with authority, you ought to call Harold. And so I gave him Harold's contact information, and he reached out to him. And then he came in my office last week. He said, thank you so much. He said, Harold Bell was extraordinary. And so he said, I am so glad. I said, well, I knew Harold was good. I said, I wasn't worried about that. He said, oh man, he really surprised me. And I started laughing. I said, he only surprised you because you don't know him, and that's what it is. If your name doesn't come up often enough, if people don't know you, if they're not plugged in, they're not going to reach out to you. And then once they do, and what'll happen is people have seen Harold now. So every time they want to do something on Ali, they're going to call Harold. And then Harold will be the one, because he's the one person they know who knew Ali personally, and that's how it works. You just kind of, you need that one break to make the others happen. And, those of us in DC who have known Harold for years have always known, and maybe in some ways taken it for granted that everybody else knew too. But we can see that didn't happen. And I think that's an issue. My question for you, though, is the feud between Ali and Frazier seemed never to have been resolved. Did Ali ever talk to you about how he felt about not being fully reconciled with Frazier?
Yeah, we talked about it. In fact, we talked about it that weekend that he was here in Washington, because I spent several hours with him in his room, and we talked about a lot of things. And we talked about Malcolm and Joe Frazier, and he wished that he could do a do-over on both of those guys. You know, he felt that he was wrong. And the thing about that, you know, I had interviews with Muhammad Ali, Joe Frazier, and George Foreman, all three of the big three. And Joe Frazier, we had in at WUST, I don't know how we got Joe Frazier to the show, but I don't remember if it was me or not, or whether it was Lou Hank as my general manager. But we had Joe in one morning, and Joe had just been knocked down about 8 times by Big George Foreman. And he was gracious enough to come on the show. And man, he had us laughing. He was bouncing off the floor. He said he felt like a bouncing ball. And he would be on the floor and we'd be cracking up. But Joe was such a good human being, man. He was. And he took care of Muhammad Ali. When Muhammad Ali was broke, he helped him with some cash. And Muhammad Ali, being the showman, you know, talked about Joe real bad. He really did. I felt bad about that myself. So I asked Muhammad, and he didn't go into a long dialogue, but he made it clear that he wished that he had never did that. You know, he felt that that was a mark on his career. And I think he got the message, or somebody got the message to Joe's family, but I don't think they've ever forgiven Muhammad Ali. Yeah, he knew he was wrong, Jackie.
I have a fond memory of Muhammad Ali. I guess I was around 23 years old, and I was working at Freedman's Hospital, and we were having an award ceremony, and I was being presented an award. And he presented the award to me, and I was like, wow, you know, he's spending time talking and whatnot. And he says, well, come on, take a picture with me. And I still have that photo. It's an 8x10.5 photo of Muhammad Ali handing me my certificate on a plaque, and I have just cherished that photo all these years, and I still have it. So it has quite some age on it, but it's not tattered, torn, or anything, because I preserved it. But he was such a gentle giant, you know, with all the talking and, like, you know, butterfly and all that business. He was a perfect gentleman and just took time and made you feel like you deserve what you got. And he was proud to present it to me, and I was proud to be there next to him. But he was a fantastic person. He really was.
If I may jump in, Harold, first off, I want to say nobody can tell a story like you. And Hattie, you are the perfect, you know, sidekick, you know, stand for Harold, you know, both y'all two together are just unstoppable, you know. And me and my wife are going to continue to emulate you too. Trust me, you know. But I want to say something. I had a brief chance to, Muhammad Ali came down to the Washington Monument. He was in DC for something. I can't remember exactly what, because it's been so long. At that time, my nephew, who was born in 76, it would have been around somewhere around 1980. He wasn't more than 3 or 4, and I took him down there with me. And of course, he didn't know who Muhammad Ali was. And Muhammad Ali, as he was coming through the crowd, I says, champ, would you just hold my nephew for a minute? Actually, I probably lied and said my son, right? You know, and he actually held him. Of course, we didn't have no cameras or anything to prove it, but I'm willing to take a polygraph if anybody doubt me. He held my nephew for like about probably 15 seconds, man. And I'll never forget that. So, and he was just nice enough to do that. I tried to do that with Donnie Simpson one time, and Donnie Simpson looked at me and said, man, I don't do that. I said, okay, brother, you know? Oh. So again, to accentuate what you said and give credence to what everyone is saying about the chances of Muhammad Ali, he was just a very down-to-earth person, and you can't be mad at him for that. And my mother and I used to watch his fights, of course, and one thing I was glad that I came up during the era when they didn't have pay-per-view. All you needed was black and white TV and rabbit antennas. Rabbit ears on that, you know, the little hanger, whatever you had to do. And that's how we watched most of his fights, along with wrestling, you know. So I'm thankful for that pay-per-view wasn't out then. Mm-hmm. So I'll shut up, but I just wanted to throw that in.
Arlena?
Oh, yes. I have a really funny story to tell you how he impacted me in my youth. In 7th grade, I was taking art class, And our assignment was to come up with like a comic strip. And the student who won would be published in the local newspaper. And so I drew Muhammad Ali and Howard Cosell in the boxing ring. And Ali in the bubble was saying, okay, Howard, you said that you would fight the winner of between me and I think it was like George Foreman. And I had Howard Cosell just shaking and shaking and shaking. He was like, but Ali, I didn't eat my Cheerios this morning. And it was published in the local newspaper. And that's his, I'm just saying, he impacted me when I was in the seventh grade. And I ended up, you know, winning the competition. So that's my story of him and that relationship he had with Howard Cosell.
Gary?
Well, I've been watching a lot of documentaries, and I watched Blood Brothers the other day on Netflix, the relationship between Muhammad Ali and Malcolm X. And at the end, there were some interviews with one of Ali's daughters and one of Malcolm X's daughters. And Malcolm X's daughter said that the champ really looked after them, the girls, after their father was assassinated. And that throughout the years, he was close to them. And he told them that if he had to do something over, he would not have broken his friendship with their dad. And the girls believed, at least this daughter believed, that that was in part maybe one of the reasons why he looked after them to make sure that they had, you know, whatever they needed. But he said that was one of his regrets. And, you know, listening to the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and severing the friendship with their dad. And I know as a kid growing up, the only time I feared for the champ was when he fought George Foreman. I thought that he was going to get destroyed because Ali had dropped Joe Frazier, who it was six times. And I'm like, man, Joe didn't back down from anybody. And Joe, and then when Joe tried to do the comeback, Joe had the bald head and he came back out and Foreman just destroyed him. I'm like, oh my goodness. But yeah, that strategy cemented him when he took that title back. And then he had the whole nation over there in Africa, they were just all for him. And poor George went over there not understanding some of the culture, going over there with a German shepherd dog and not understanding a lot of stuff. It's a lot to be learned from watching Ali, but his consciousness about the war, his willingness to die and for the country and being clear about it. He said, I'm not going anyplace else. This is my country. And if this is the way it has to be, this is the way it has to be. And as you pointed out on the documentary the other night, which I'm sure Ken Burns and his son-in-law and daughter-in-law, they were smart enough not to say, but you said it when Ali said, ain't no Viet Cong ever call me nigger. Yeah. You know, I mean, but he was willing, the consciousness that he had at such a young age, something that you don't see much of today.
Michael Jackson, I didn't forget you. I forgot what I said. I don't see your face up there. Michael?
Yeah, I'm trying to do some washing and cleaning. But look, I didn't have the pleasure of ever meeting Ali. I told y'all he was my favorite athlete. But the closest I ever came to the boxers is meeting Evander Holyfield. Of course, he's from Atlanta. So, but I met him probably a few years after he retired. He might have fought one or two more fights, but I had to meet him at this celebrity golf charity event, Evander Holyfield. And to be honest, back then he wasn't in the best shape then, and I see what recently happened in his last fight. But Ali has always been my favorite. And hearing your stories, Harold, I'm going to have to say again, you have to write your book. You just have to, because I all these stories about that Ali and the intimate details, we'll never know that, we never would have known about all this. And the other thing is, I was just wondering, did you ever get a chance to meet his last wife and his kids and get to know them?
No, I did not. I never got a chance to meet Lonnie. My favorite, of course, was Veronica and Layla Ali. In fact, I was closer to them than anybody else. Rockman, his brother, and I were real close. Was really, Rockman was the man that kept me in touch with his brother, because if I couldn't get in touch with Muhammad Ali, Rock's number, and Rock would make sure that Muhammad Ali knew I was trying to get in touch with him. One other thing we got to understand too, I was listening to Jacques talk about Muhammad Ali taking his nephew and holding him. Man, one thing that he loved was a beautiful woman and children. Man, if they were anywhere around, you had to go back to the back of the line, because he loved some children. And that's one thing, great thing about my interview with him. Like I said, we only talked about 2 minutes of boxing. The rest was about Black women and children, man, who he cherished, who he respected, man. So my interview is so unique because I got the only interview with him with a Black eye. There's no other interview on the planet with him doing something with someone with a mark on his face. He didn't play that, man. He wouldn't let you interview him with a Black eye. And that morning when I hit New York and I walked up and saw him in there, he was standing in the door, combing his hair, telling me, ain't I pretty? Did he see me? Don't I still look good? I said, you got that Black eye. He said, okay now. But he was, man, he said, come on in, man, sit down. Did the interview, man, like the Black eye wasn't even there. And if you ever see anybody steal my interview, you see him with a Black eye, they said, they done stole that from Harold Bell. You know, I am the only one that he's ever did a radio promo for. You know, the only one that he's ever did a radio promo. So I feel real special, man, because he was a special guy, man. And I'm just sorry that he's not still here, man, because he has such an impact on everybody. Folks that didn't like Muhammad Ali, they didn't like themselves. That's the bottom line there. Yeah.
That didn't it change over time? I can remember when people treated Muhammad Ali like he was, you know, America enemy number one. Mm-hmm. And over time, you know, you went from people being fearful of him. And I'm sure a lot of that was the connection with Elijah Muhammad, but he was treated as sort of this danger. And then over time he became beloved. And clearly he didn't change. So what happened in society that made them change the way they looked at it?
Jackie, you got to remember, Martin Luther King went through the same thing. Jackie Robinson went through the same thing. Any successful Blacks, man, that stand up to help other Blacks, man, they're going to be looked down not only by whites, but other Blacks. And that's it, man. You know one thing that I love about this guy, he handled success. He did not let success handle him. And that is that's the problem with so many of our Black politicians, Black athletes, Black entertainers. They don't know how to handle success. They let success handle them. So we had a very special man in Muhammad Ali, and I am so blessed that he allowed me to be a part of his life. All right, Chris?
I like this.
Okay.
I was going to say very quickly that I love the way that you use the term man, even though you're using it somewhat loosely. Nowadays, as you stated also in the same breath, people are known for being a politician, for an entertainer, for socialite, for everything else, but nobody wants to be you don't really hear, you know, this person is a man. You know, there were a time we used to say, black power, you the man. Now it's something, you know, it's all kind of other names that we, taglines that we give on the people. And I've always appreciated real men and real women. So I want to say that without sounding biased, but it probably did sound biased. But I just really, really, cherish the fact that we had real men and real women in this world at one time.
Mm-hmm. Christopher, come on back in here, man.
Yeah, absolutely. Like I said, Ali is just one of the first cases of athlete challenging those power structures. Like I said, racial inequality, imperialism, with not going to that war and being so vocal about it and open up a lot of people's eyes. So, yeah, we've seen it through and through and time again, as you said, since Ali, other people that have taken up the mantle, we've seen how the power structure moves against those people. Like Colin Kaepernick is a good example. When you challenge those power structures, they coalesce to try to tarnish your name and your legacy and to try to take you down. And Ali was the forefather of that. Like I said, I don't think there's any bigger, braver stance against anti-imperialism and war. Like my dad said, ain't no Viet Cong ever tried to call me a nigger. I'm not going over there to kill them just because the US government says so. And then in hindsight, we see how that war and our subsequent imperialist wars have gone. We just saw how Afghanistan went. We've seen how these places go. So it turns out, looks like Ali was absolutely right. As he, and I'm sure that wasn't the sentiment back in the day. You know, when that happens, I know people like to, in hindsight, like that, show reverence to people like Ali and Dr. Martin Luther King. But back in the day, they were the same people, you know, fighting against those causes. So trying to move against that. And that's pretty much it on, my part.
Well, one of the things too, I want to bring to everyone's attention about Muhammad Ali, when we talk about success, you know, he made a lot of money. But he gave a lot of money away, man. It wasn't about a dollar bill with him, man. You know, if he hadn't assigned that $50 million proposal with that the group out of New York, that he sold the rights to his likeness and his name for $50 million plus 20% of the advertising. Now, no telling how much money those folks have made over the years, the group that handles his estate. And my thing is, man, that each one of Muhammad Ali's children and his brother Rahman, who is only sibling, they should be getting a check every month from that group, man. If you look at Muhammad Ali's children, except for Layla, who's her own woman, her own millionaire, you know, those kids, man, are struggling to make it. But here's an estate that oversees their father's money, and a lot of them are struggling to make it, man. Rahman, his older brother, has dementia. Beautiful brother. And he's struggling around. So what's happening with the money? It wasn't never about greed with Muhammad Ali. So I know he does not appreciate what's going on today with his family, man. And I just feel bad about that, because I know how he was, man. He cared not about the money. Guys stole from him. He knew they were stealing. He knew Bundy and all of them were stealing gloves and shoes. He didn't care about nothing about none of that stuff. Don King stole. He put Don King in position to become the first professional boxing promoter in the history of the sport. I was there in Cleveland when he gave him that opportunity in 1972. What did Don King do? Steal from him. All you had to do was ask him for it. He would have given it to you. And then when Muhammad Ali said he was going to cam the court, and Don King said, you'll die before you get this money, and then send $50,000 by one of his guys to Muhammad Ali lying in his hospital bed. $50,000 in cash, and told Muhammad Ali, said, Don said, you need to take this because you're not going to get it anymore. And Muhammad Ali took it. You know, those are the kind of things and stories, man, that go around. You won't see, man, in this thing here, man, but there's some real stories. And before we get out here, I'm going to go around and give everybody a minute before they get out. But I remember Gene Kilroy, who was white and was Muhammad Ali's business manager. He came up to me one day in the casino out in Las Vegas. I was out there for the fight. And he said, Harold, if you had played the game, you would be a multimillionaire over and over again. He said, if you had played the game, they would have been calling Howard Cosell the Black Harold Bell. I said, wow. Gene. But Gene that was his kind of guy. He called it like he saw him, man. So yeah, man, I feel good about that relationship. And I'm blessed that I'm still here to talk about it. In October, well, Hattie and I celebrate 53 years of marriage in November. In October will be the 47th anniversary of the Rumble in the Jungle. December, we will mark 53-year anniversary of our toy party for needy children, you know? So we've been blessed, man, to still be here and to be able to call Muhammad Ali the greatest and our friend. And that's what it's all about. Let's go around and Jackie, let's start with you up top. Take a minute or two to close out. Oh yeah, I forgot to tell you, Jackie used to be producer of Inside Sports, my radio show too. I forgot to tell you all that, okay.
Yeah, we go way back. Now I remember, Harold, remember when I didn't even like to talk about boxing on the show. Whenever he was interviewing somebody talking about boxing, he couldn't even get me to talk. I just passed to the next person in the round table. But I think that it's really important, you know, as others said earlier today, for you to write that book, Harold, because you've got the stories to tell. And, you know, that shouldn't go unnoticed, you know, unpinned, and you should get all the credit you deserve for what you know, because you've got more, you've forgotten more than most of us will ever remember. And I think it's important that we get it out there. And you have my pledge on the record to work with you in getting that book done, because I want to make sure that the tale gets told.
Okay. Arlena? Arlena, close us out. Take a minute to close us out, Arlena.
Oh, no, I just wanted to say thank you so much, you know, for and all of you for sharing. I have had an opportunity to meet some of the boxing greats, but the one thing that Muhammad Ali said, he was on the cover of Personal Branding magazine, the very first issue. I think the editor was Stedman Graham, and this was back in the the early 2000s, and he was on the cover, and it was about the personal brand, the greatest. And there's one thing that Muhammad Ali said that really stuck with me, and he said, sometimes you have to say no to a good opportunity. And so that really, and that there's wisdom in that. And so I just want to say thank you to everybody. And this was time well spent, and congratulations to you and your wife, Harold. Keep hanging in there and keep making it happen.
I will. Okay, Michael, close us out.
I think this show was very important, because talking about friendship, it is hard. You're lucky if you have one friend in your whole life, a true friend. But I did want to say, I want to focus just about how we done these boxes after they retire in really bad shape. And now they're trying to fight to their 60, 65 to make some money. And unlike other sports, they don't have that union or that league or whatever to take care of them with insurance and money advice and all kinds of other stuff. So that's my comment.
Thank you. Thank you, Michael. Dr. Julie Fisher.
I just want to say thank you, too, for remembering greats. Our African-American greats in sports. I had my half-brother was known as Little Joe Lewis years ago when I was a kid, but he had a car accident, and when he woke up the next morning, he couldn't walk, and he was paralyzed the rest of his life. But it's just so nice, because we need to pay homage to these men and women who have managed to get to great heights in their lives. And it's an honor for all of us to remember them. We should tell it to our children, our families should know of them, and they should be cherished.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hattie T.
Yes.
You got a last word.
Oh, I'm just thankful to be who I am, to be so I can know all these people through my husband. And it's a pleasure, I enjoy it. everything, every moment. Even when we went out to where's Muhammad's museum?
Oh yeah, she's been there twice. I haven't been there at all.
One time they have monitors of him boxing, and I wanted to see every. Unlike you, Jackie, I love boxing. I think that's my first sport that I like. In fact, Harold, that was my first date.
Took her to a boxing match.
Yeah.
I sure did.
So anyway, when I was out there to the museum, what do they call it? Anyway, I was with my sister. And she left me on the floor with the monitors because I was trying to take in every fight. And so she said a couple came down there and told her, said, are you looking for your friend? Because she's up there going from monitor to monitor. We're running around going from monitor to monitor. They thought I was going crazy. Okay. I was trying to finish and catch up with her. But I enjoy every moment, everything.
All right. Christopher, you got a job too. Go ahead, Christopher.
It's another great show, productive conversation. I think it goes back to the light of people and their platform and how they used to use it. It's very rare that you have a great, all-time great, not just athlete, but person, an icon like Ali, want to use their platform and use their influence for something positive. Like I said, to reach back in the community when we see so many times that those people don't. And the industry picks people, and the different industries pick people that won't. You know, there's a very bias of who they choose to amplify. I hear this argument a lot in the music industry of why is there always all these rappers who are gangster rappers and don't, you know, are not conscious, who are about thug this and thug that. That's who the industry chooses to amplify. It's record executives in Columbia and Universal. Those are white guys sitting in offices that are picking the winners and losers. Those are picking who's getting those $1 million deals and who's getting amplified and whose messages. Same with athletes, you know. There are certain athletes with certain, again, going back to the Kaepernick example, the ones that talk a little too much or a little socially conscious, they don't get the same reach as the ones that promote ignorance or promote things that will be, you know, to a capitalistic agenda. So it's just another reason that made Ali so great beyond just being the greatness in the ring.
Right. Jacques?
I just want to say with accentuation, enunciation, pronunciation, I am delighted with the motivation today. That's my rhyme. That's in tribute to Muhammad Ali. I'm out. Don't laugh. You weren't supposed to laugh, Harold.
Gary. Gary.
Jock looked like he was trying so hard not to mess that up, boy.
Hey, Gary, I know he was. Hey, Gary, you had mentioned something earlier about how you had went and Googled Harold Bell and Muhammad Ali, and how you found that black men in America is read all over the world. Tell us about that. I think people need to know about that.
Yeah, I'm always looking at the analytics. And so I was checking the analytics. I check them like once a month. I like to see what pages, what authors and what writers are doing and, you know, what people like when they come to the site. Because when I first started the site, the overwhelming majority of people used to use desktops, and now it's all mostly mobile. It used to be men. The majority of people who visit the site used to be men. Now, more women visit Black Men in America than men. And so then I was looking at, okay, what countries? And I figured, I know the U.S. is one, but I was looking at the analytics the other day, and of course, the number one country site visitors comes from the U.S., followed by China and Indonesia. And then the UK, and then Canada, and going down. But I'm like, okay, China, Indonesia, and then of course I look at the what people put in for Google. What are the searches? How do they reach us through Google? And what names pop up the most? Your name pops up more than anybody, Harold Bell. So people in China and Indonesia and other people, I don't know, whatever it is, they know who Harold Bell is. Some people in China and Indonesia, So I guess it's better that you pop up there than you have offspring over there, you know? So I guess it's better to pop up on Google than have that.
Oh, man. Hey, I just want to say, man, I want to thank everybody. And once again, thank Maryland Public Television. And it really ain't over to the Fat Lady Sings. We still in the ball game. Of course, I got some things that I'm hoping that we can carry to the next level. And I'm glad in a way that Ken Burns is doing his thing with Muhammad Ali, because it has helped me. So, you know, you got to be very careful, man, about claiming that, man, we're not getting this and got that. God has a plan for us. We don't have our own plan. So over these years, between him and Hattie, I am who I am today. And once again, Michael Jackson, and of course, Arlena, Jackie, Dr. Fisher, and of course, Jacques and Gary, man, thanks so much. And don't forget, that series starts tonight at 7 o'clock on PBS. So check it out. And is it 8 o'clock? Okay. Well, I thought it was, somebody told me 7 is 8 o'clock, but just catch it between 7 and 8.
What do they say? Check your local listings to be sure.
check your local listing. Once again, just remember that every black face you see is not your brother, and every white face is not your enemy. And hey, man, just remember, like I always say, man, you cannot soar with eagles if you're hanging out with chickens. Muhammad Ali didn't hang out with no chickens, believe me. Okay, Gary.
No, that's it. Just be safe, everybody, and look for that documentary, because I'm agree with Jackie Jones that now when Ali comes up because of Ken Burns, people are going to start saying, you know, we got to get the man who knows him better than anybody. And that's Harold Bell. So, yeah, they've done you a favor. It's about time. Be safe, everybody.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Hi, I'm Harold Bell. My wife Hattie and I found the nonprofit organization in 1968, shortly after the riots that almost destroyed my hometown, Washington, D.C. The program caters to the needs of at-risk children as it relates to social services such as education, law enforcement, drug abuse, gang-related violence, and other antisocial behavior.